各位业界先进，大家好，欢迎参加印尼消费性电子市场商机线上研讨会。我是外贸协会产业拓展处电子资通讯组林秉义。这个研讨会将深入介绍印尼消费性电子市场的潜在商机。印尼共有2.6亿的人口，是东协最大的经济体，但是印尼国内自制的电子相关产品只能供应国内30%的需求。剩下的70%都仰赖进口，因此非常具有拓销的潜力。为此，我们邀请了印尼 Bede Subramulia Hasyoguna 以及 Bede Ubenhideo International 这两家公司的执行长，分享印尼消费性电子产业的布局、政府的产业政策，以及掌握后疫情时代的商机。首先，我们来介绍第一位讲师。北戴 Subramulia Hasyoguna 执行长 Mr. Susanto，欢迎 Mr. Susanto。
大家好，我是杨昌龙。People call me in Indonesia, Joe Susanto. I speak a little Mandarin, and even though I speak English, but I prefer to make this presentation in Bahasa, so I can speak fluently. Okay.Saya mulai bergelut di dunia IT tahun 1989, memulai karier di Metro Data. Di tahun 1995, saya berpatungan dengan beberapa teman membangun usaha komputer dengan nama perusahaan PT Sumber Mulia Hasyoguna, dan belakangan kami menggunakan merek dagang IT Gallery. Bagi para teman kita dari Taiwan, mungkin ada yang belum mengenal mengenai Indonesia. Makanya saya coba menjelaskan sedikit mengenai Indonesia. Dari slide, Anda bisa lihat bahwa Indonesia kalau dibandingkan dengan Australia, ya kurang lebih daratan ditambah dengan laut mirip, ya, karena Indonesia disebut sebagai negara kepulauan terbesar di dunia. Oke, bagaimana dengan jumlah penduduk di Indonesia? Dari hasil sensus tahun 2020 terakhir menunjukkan bahwa penduduk Indonesia mencapai 270 juta jiwa, di mana 70%-nya itu berusia produktif, artinya di range umur 15 sampai 64 tahun. Dan Indonesia memiliki Gen Z dan milenial di atas 50%. Jadi kalau dari hasil sensus ini menunjukkan bahwa Indonesia akan segera mendapatkan bonus demografi untuk tahun 2030 mendatang. Oke, selanjutnya adalah sebagai Indonesia, sebagai negara berpenduduk terbesar di dunia, nomor 4, memiliki distribusi penduduk masing-masing 56% di Jawa, 21% di Sumatera, 7% di Sulawesi, 6% di Kalimantan, 5% di Bali Nusa, dan 3% di Maluku, termasuk Papua. Sehingga Indonesia berpeluang memiliki beberapa megacity. Dari jumlah sensus kemarin kita menunjukkan bahwa 22 kota di Indonesia yang memiliki potensi untuk itu, masing-masing dari Jakarta hingga ke Balikpapan. Kita masuk kepada pasar. Peluang pasar untuk barang elektronik komputer di Indonesia. Inflasi di tahun 2019 menunjukkan cukup terkendali, berada di kisaran 2-3,5%. Tetapi memasuki tahun 2020, sebagai dampak dari pandemi, ada penurunan inflasi. Sehingga menyebabkan daya beli mulai melemah. Sekarang kita lihat berapa besar sih pasar consumer electronic goods di Indonesia. Itu data yang kami peroleh dari GfK dari Januari sampai Desember 2020. Itu hampir stabil, meskipun di bulan Maret hingga Mei menunjukkan ada penurunan drastis, tapi itu pun cepat kembali berbalik di bulan Agustus sampai bahkan mencapai puncaknya di bulan Desember dengan total unit penjualan 7,6 juta dan nilainya mencapai 14,9 triliun. Oke, kita sekarang melihat kepada total technical consumer goods. Meskipun penjualan total consumer electronic goods masih didominasi oleh offline, sejak akhir 2019 sampai 2020, online mulai meningkat cukup signifikan baik dari sisi volume maupun nilainya ya, yang hampir meningkat 2 kali lipat. Total market menunjukkan penurunan dari jumlah unit yang berkurang sebesar 5%, tapi dari sisi nilai meningkat 3,4%. Laptop sendiri mengalami kontraksi hingga 19%, tetapi dari sisi value masih cukup bagus, yaitu hanya berkurang 0,6%. Laptop di Indonesia itu masih didominasi oleh layar berukuran 13-14%, dan offline masih memegang peranan dengan penjualan 82%. Dan seperti kita ketahui, brand-brand yang berperanan di Indonesia adalah Asus, Lenovo, Acer, dan HP. Tapi 2 tahun belakangan ini mulai Apple meningkat cukup drastis dengan MacBook Air-nya yang terjangkau. Bagaimana dengan demand untuk barang-barang consumer elektronik di tahun 2021 ini? Kalau kita melihat, pemerintah Indonesia sangat mendukung pertumbuhan ekonomi, mulai dari investasi dan pengembangan infrastruktur tetap berlanjut secara masif. Investasi masuk ke Indonesia meningkat, neraca ekspor dan impor cenderung positif, sehingga konsumsi masyarakat mulai membaik. JFK secara optimis memprediksi GDP kita akan meningkat 6% di tahun 2021 ini. Dan permintaan terhadap barang consumer elektronik, terutama fablek, diperkirakan akan tumbuh 2 kali lipat, termasuk food preparation sebesar 24%. Laptop akan meningkat 4%. Kita berlanjut kepada IT Gallery. IT Gallery sendiri didirikan tahun 1995. Dan visi kita adalah menjadi perusahaan retail terkemuka di Indonesia. Misi kita adalah bekerja sama dengan merek produsen ternama, terpercaya, dan memiliki teknologi yang unggul. Demikian pula kita akan selalu menampilkan, menawarkan produk-produk berkualitas yang fresh dan dengan harga yang kompetitif. Sekarang ini kita memiliki 24 cabang toko di Jabodetabek dengan jumlah karyawan 154 orang. Filosofi dari IT Gallery sendiri adalah menitikberatkan pada people, produk, baru disusul dengan profit. Dan mantra kita adalah berpikir besar, mulai dengan langkah kecil tapi sehat, cepat supaya hasilnya bisa efektif. Sekarang ini kita bekerja sama dengan beberapa teknologi owner terbesar dan terkemuka di dunia, mulai dari AMD, Intel, Nvidia, Microsoft, dan McAfee. Dan pun merek-merek yang terpercaya seperti Acer, Asus, Dell, Dynabook, Hewlett Packard, Huawei, Legion, Lenovo, MSI, Microsoft, dan McAfee sendiri. Ada pula beberapa sporting brand seperti JBL yang tak asing lagi, Logitech, SteelSeries, Razer, dan belakangan kita mulai merambah ke dunia audio. Kita mulai memasarkan produk dari UK dengan merek Ruak. Untuk konsumen kita, kebanyakan adalah pasar menengah ke atas, sehingga barang yang dibeli juga cukup bernilai, sehingga kita cover dengan proteksi dari pasar polis supaya memberikan rasa aman, nyaman berbelanja di IT Gallery. Ini ada sederetan penghargaan yang sudah kita peroleh selama ini, di mana menunjukkan bahwa memang IT Gallery memiliki fokus dan performance yang bagus di dunia retail, khususnya untuk IT dan laptop. Kenapa begitu? Karena kita memiliki beberapa konsep store di bawah nama IT Gallery. Selain itu juga ada exclusive store dari masing-masing brand, mulai dari Acer, Asus, HP, Lenovo, MSI, dan terakhir kita coba kembangin juga dengan nama eSport Gallery, karena gaming mulai mendapat pasar yang cukup bagus di Indonesia. Dari semua itu membuat kita memiliki aset bukan hanya di online tapi juga di offline. Nah, bagaimana persiapan IT Gallery menuju pasar digital? Karena kita tahu perkembangan e-commerce di Indonesia lagi booming, ya. Didukung oleh pengguna internet mencapai 200 juta yang aktif di sosial media 170 juta. Bahkan jumlah koneksi internet mencapai 340 juta di bulan Januari 2021. Ini menandakan penetrasi digital Indonesia sudah tidak main-main dan sangat-sangat masif. Sehingga kita harus mempersiapkan diri untuk bisnis online. Kita bisa lihat bahwa jumlah pembeli atau shop online shopper di Indonesia itu melebihi 30 juta orang dan diperkirakan akan tumbuh terus hingga tahun 2022 mencapai 44 juta jiwa. Di masa pandemi ini juga merupakan faktor atau kalau boleh dibilang katalisator mempercepat pergeseran pasar offline ke online. Kenapa? Karena ditunjang oleh berbagai prasarana dan sarana, termasuk fasilitas dan kemudahan berbelanja. Tapi apakah demikian mudahnya? Tentu tidak, ada tantangan juga. Apa sih tantangannya? Yang pertama pasti masalah logistik. Karena Indonesia seperti yang saya sebutkan tadi adalah merupakan negara kepulauan. Dari Sabang sampai Merauke ya. Kemudian yang kedua adalah koneksi internet yang masih lambat. Dan sebagian besar pembayaran pun masih melalui transfer bank secara tradisional. Dikarenakan karena jumlah penduduk Indonesia baru 36% yang layak banking. Di sisi lain juga, pembeli juga, maksud saya pembeli yang berbelanja online juga masih belum sepenuhnya percaya kepada e-commerce. Kenapa begitu? Karena dari pengalaman kami, pembeli sebelum melakukan pembayaran masih membutuhkan interaksi dengan penjual untuk meyakinkan kondisi stok, kwalitas barang, ataupun sekaligus menanyakan mengenai reputasi dari penjual itu sendiri. Oke, jadi apa jawaban kita terhadap tantangan ini? Saya rasa adalah sistem penjualan online harus dipadukan atau paling tidak didukung oleh offline. Artinya apa? Customer yang ingin belanja online bisa ambil di toko, atau sebaliknya, pada saat berbelanja di toko, bisa memilih barang dan berbelanja secara online. Hingga kepada pengembalian barang yang dibelanja secara online di toko fisik. Sehingga customer merasa nyaman, aman berbelanja di toko ataupun di e-commerce. Oke, perlu kiranya diketahui distribution dan sales channel yang ada di Indonesia. Produsen menuju ke konsumen melalui beberapa pihak, mulai dari importir, wholesaler atau di Indonesia lebih dikenal sebagai distributor, dan kami salah satunya adalah retailer. Di sini kita masih membutuhkan importir karena sebagian besar barang komputer ataupun consumer elektronik itu diproduksi di luar negeri. Jadi untuk para produsen perlu mengetahui prosedur dan izin impor barang dari luar negeri supaya tidak mengalami kesulitan pada saat melakukan importasi. Dan kami IT Gallery sendiri bermaksud mengembangkan portofolio produk yang ada sekarang. Jadi tidak hanya bergantung pada laptop, tapi juga merambah ke peripheral, aksesoris, dan pelengkapnya, terutama produk-produk dengan desain yang unik yang punya potensi dijual secara online. Harapan kami selain bisa meningkatkan pendapatan, juga tentunya keuntungan bagi perusahaan melalui suatu bentuk kerjasama yang strategik dan saling membutuhkan. Demikian presentasi materi dari saya. Semoga bisa bermanfaat bagi para produsen atau pelaku pasar dari Taiwan yang ingin berinvestasi atau melakukan penetrasi pasar ke Indonesia. Terima kasih. Untuk selanjutnya, bagi Anda yang berminat bekerja sama atau menjajah pasar Indonesia, bisa menghubungi Business Development Manager saya, Jovanus Arlo, di nomor yang ada di nomor dan alamat email yang ada di slide kami ini. Terima kasih. Bagi para produsen atau pelaku pasar yang memang berminat bekerja sama dengan IT Gallery, saya silakan bisa menghubungi Jovanus Arlo selaku Business Development Manager kami melalui nomor telepon dan alamat email di bawah ini. Terima kasih.
非常感谢 Mr. Susanto 与我们分享印尼 O2O 的未来。再来，第二位讲师是 Bede Uben Hidel International 的执行长 Mr. Suwadi。欢迎 Mr. Suwadi。
Hi, my name is Suwardi Suryadi, and I'm from Jakarta, Indonesia. Today, I would like to discuss about the growing trend of cross-border e-commerce in Indonesia. I'm the founder of Urban Life, which is established in 2013. We are a global trading company with offices in three different countries in Southeast Asia, and the headquarters is in Jakarta, Indonesia. And we have two branch offices in Hong Kong and Singapore. And we have six branch offices nationwide in Indonesia, such as Semarang, Surabaya, Bali, Medan, Yogyakarta, and Nusa Tenggara Timur, NTT. Urban Retail International's main focus is importing and distributing consumer electronic and lifestyle products. And recently, we have opened a fulfillment center to create an opportunity for overseas sellers to open an e-commerce store in Indonesia. Our mission is to deliver the latest trending, best design, quality consumer electronic product and lifestyle. And our mission is always searching for innovative product around the world. And we also work closely with the reliable supplier to deliver wow through service. And we also focus on consumer needs. And year by year, we pursue significant growth. We build positive and effective teamwork. And our team is passionate about the product that we sell. Our main focus product will be Marshall headphone. It's a UK brand. We have Marshall speaker and Marshall headphone. And we have Moshi as a Taiwan brand that focus in mobile accessories. And we have a Kate Spade for mobile accessories. We do have Givatec and also Belkin and many others. Our company has been distributing a lot of brands since 2013. And we have also opened up 9 retail stores, 7 in throughout Jakarta and 2 in Bali. Our distribution channel consists of 8 different channels: Apple reseller, electronic store, music store, modern bookstore, mobile distributor, department store, and lifestyle store. Sorry, there's 7 stores, 7 channels. Indonesian rapid e-commerce expansion is fueled by mobile commerce, make it a key destination for ambitious merchants. Indonesia e-commerce market at present only takes a small percentage of overall retail. But with a young population which increasingly rely on their smartphone, the country represents a huge opportunity for merchants to enter a growth market. A key local platform are Tokopedia, Bukalapak, and Shopee. This could provide a route to the market for international merchants that are increasingly courting collaboration and investment from Western e-commerce brands. Importing items means navigating a range of newly established import rules and taxes, which might not be that simple in Indonesia. There are key physical and digital infrastructure barriers too, to ensure a smooth e-commerce experience in Indonesia. International merchants that can sidestep this, for example, by honing their own application, payments, and delivery infrastructure, could set themselves apart from the competition. So how tiny is e-commerce compared to the total retail sales? It made up only 3%. Nevertheless, Indonesian population is 270 million people, is migrating towards e-commerce. A big shift that has been expedited this year by the stay-home notice or measure during the COVID-19 pandemic. From a small baseline, Indonesia's remarkable e-commerce growth. Annual revenue almost doubled between 2017 and 2019, has made it a target for Western investment. In the second of 2020, the sale of one country top 3 e-commerce merchants such as Tokopedia has become the focus of Western internet giant, hoping to gain access to the healthy growth this country represents. Google, Amazon, and Facebook are among those who have experienced interest in the company. So all merchants, domestic and international, face the challenge of Indonesian island topography. We have estimated 17,500 islands, 6,000 of which are inhabited, could make delivery very difficult. In rural region, for example, street often lacks official names. They can name whatever streets they like to. And in urban areas, there are often duplication of street names, creating complication. They can drive up costs for merchants and slow down the delivery times. Ongoing double-digit sales growth is predicted. Indonesia e-commerce value has rapidly risen since 2017. If you can see from the graph, from 11.5 billion in 2017, it spikes up to almost double to 19 billion in 2019. And it is set up to continue growing at a compound annual growth rate of 14.8% to 2023. One of the higher prediction in 2020 report series. This prediction reflects the country's relative e-commerce immaturity compared to other nations such as US and China. Sales have historically relied on peer-to-peer commerce via platform like Shopee. And as more merchants enter the country, business to consumer, or they call it B2C, e-commerce will become increasingly more important. And another point to point out is Indonesia is a young nation. The average age is only 31 years old. Growth over the medium to long term will be supported by the increasing number of digital natives starting to earn and spend for their first time. Mobile commerce has outweighed desktop usage in the face of ongoing internet availability issue. Indonesia is a mobile-first e-commerce market, with 58% of transactions completed on mobile device. Optimizing mobile shopping services is therefore vital to accessing the Indonesian consumer. Mobile commerce growth is set to continue at a compound annual growth rate at 20.3% up to 2023, making its dominance even wider. And smartphone penetration is far lower than any other countries. It's only at 28%. This will rise as younger generation gain access to smartphone. Nationwide, internet penetration is very fragmented at 56.2%. Fixed line internet infrastructure is relatively underdeveloped, which has led to a reliance on your smartphone. Although 4G mobile connectivity is improving, there are significant and ongoing issues with internet infrastructure availability. At present, there is not enough spectrum available for full 4G deployment. As a result, 5G deployment is likely several years later. The best way to access Indonesian shopper is via a finance app. I will say a mobile application. Almost 7 out of every 10 e-commerce transactions is completed on an application. As you can see from the graph on the left side, 58% e-commerce is completed on a mobile device. And out of this e-commerce from the mobile device is divided by 69% completed through an application. And the rest of 31% is through a mobile browser. Smartphones are essential tools for marketing. Almost 98% of Indonesian mobile consumers do their research. They research about the brands and products through their handphone, to their smartphone. And 80% have changed their mind during their purchase journey as a result of this research. Prior to COVID-19, travel was the most important merchant segment, which take almost 32% of the transaction. While this will likely to recover in the midterm, the second and third most important market is fashion and consumer electronics, which made up 17% each. And next to it is the household goods, which made up 11%. World experienced strong growth throughout the year. High level of cross-border spending is a key feature of Indonesian e-commerce. Let's talk about China. China is the most popular overseas shopping destination, followed by the US and Singapore. All of these countries offer a wide choice of products, sophisticated e-commerce infrastructure, and a very competitive pricing. Cross-border e-commerce is exploding in terms of parcel volume. Indonesia has witnessed 814% increase, or almost 8 times, imported e-commerce parcel. So from 6.1 million packages to 49.7 million packages in 2019. However, from January 2020, the diminished exemption on shipment imported goods into Indonesia was revised downwards from $70 per shipment down to $3 per shipment on all imported goods. The VAT on this item is now charged 10% regardless of any product. For item above $3, a range of import taxes apply. So on top of this VAT 10%, there are other import taxes apply, which can sum up to easily to 30 to 40% range. Some merchants are choosing to bulk import product and work with local distributor, selling platform and trading houses to circumvent this, like us. So we work with a lot of international resellers, seller that wants to have an opportunity to sell their product into Indonesia. So for the newcomers, they need to understand a fast-moving regulatory environment in Indonesia means merchants must pay close attention to changes. There are three big trends that they have to pay attention to, such as regulation and trends. The Indonesian government is introducing a raft of measures designed to recover greater tax from the e-commerce, including the import taxes outlined above. Newcomers have to stay on top of things for this shifting of rules and regulation. Secondly, barrier or benefit to e-commerce market entry. Courier may be a way to provide prompt delivery, but this will drive up costs. The state-owned National Postal Service, PT POS Indonesia, has struggled with a lack of local infrastructure. They have been around for many years and still struggling, and also with a low consumer postal charges, which is claimed to be below cost of service. It is recently claimed by the PT POS Indonesia president. Indonesian banking sector, however, is evolving quickly. The Bank of Indonesia is in the process of drafting standardized open banking and application programming interface, API, framework to support greater digital commerce. However, at this present, there is no faster payment scheme in Indonesia. So you need to work with a local entity to enter the market. Local entity such as bank transfer or a mobile payment gateway. We have four big ones, such as GoPay, OVO, ShopeePay, and Dana. And last but not all, we have factor that driving the cost of payment acceptance. PayPal charges merchant 4.4% of the transaction value plus 0.3 fee per transaction. That's ridiculous to some product categories, especially smartphones. However, Doku Wallet is cheaper, charging merchants only 2% of the transaction value. And we have also many other that is coming in to provide a cheaper transaction cost as we speak. In 2020, we have learned from this COVID-19 pandemic, and then we have re-strategized our company and on our mission. It's simply summarized into 4 factors. Firstly, we are now focusing on e-commerce. We are developing an omni-channel to integrate 8 big marketplaces into a single platform, so we can easily manage our customer order, and then we can process it and we can deliver it within 1 and 2 hours window. But that's within Jakarta and surrounding. We call it Jabodetabek. Jakarta, Bogor, Bekasi, and Tangerang area. And then, secondly, we are very focused on social media, such as Instagram. And then we use IG Live and IGTV to promote our product, or to do product launching, or even product review. And we have also deploy a TikTok video that's to grab into a younger audience. And we have also set up a team to be focused on YouTube channel and Spotify podcast. This will be mainly focused on the product review or even the brand review. And thirdly, we have developed an online to offline commerce. This way, we can create a seamless digital experience at all stages, before, during, and after the purchase. Last but not least, we have a fulfillment center. This is to create an opportunity for overseas sellers to open an e-commerce store locally and be managed by local team, and to deliver the product in a fast and timely manner. I guess that's about it. If we are welcome for any international seller that wants to open an e-commerce store in Indonesia, across all the marketplace, we will help you manage the team, the store. Most but not least, we will deliver the product in a fast manner. And you can contact the number below or just hit us an email. We are looking forward to work with you guys. Thank you.
感谢各位的收看，请扫描画面中的 QR Code 完成问卷。除了可以借由您的回馈，让我们把市场研讨会办得更好，也可以获得更多的市场拓销资讯。我们下次再见。